Welcome to Brains Matter, the podcast on science, curiosities, and general knowledge. I'm your host, just an ordinary guy.
Welcome everyone to the show. I would like to thank you all for coming here. Welcome to National Science Week. It's Sunday the 15th of August 2012, broadcasting from Melbourne, Australia. So thanks to everyone for coming along so far, and I hope you've enjoyed what you've seen and heard. Corin's talk on chocolate, Clive's music, and this is actually being streamed worldwide via Ustream, so those people listening on the net, you can listen via Ustream, so you can also participate by using Twitter. Just use the #BrainsMatter hashtag, and our special Twitter expert will convey your questions along. And anyone here who has questions, please convey them to our questions expert, and you can answer those questions as well. For everyone who does have a question, just stick your hand up. I'll point to you. You can go to Sandra and use that microphone there. That's going to be the audience microphone. And on that note, I'd like to introduce a very special guest today, Professor Patricia Vickers-Rich, who's the Chair in Palaeontology at Monash University and the founding director of the Monash Science Centre. And if I went through everything she's done, it's going to take the rest of the day. Just suffice to say, we're very, very lucky to have her here. So could everyone please welcome Patricia. Well, today's topic is from slime to dinosaurs. Let's start right at the beginning, and let's talk about how long the Earth has been around.
I just had to start out with slime, because that's me when I was about four, and I'm playing with slime in the river, so this is where we start. And the next slide that we've got will show the Earth as we now understand it. And the Earth is quite old. It's about, well, can I ask you how old you think it is? Yeah. He's going in the right direction. It's over 4 billion years old. And I don't have a time to go into why. We know that, but it is a very old place. But as far as the rest of the universe, pretty young.
And what are the timescales we're talking about here? Because the universe, as far as I understand, is about 14 billion years old. Mm-hmm. We just said the Earth's about 4 billion years old. What happened in the meantime? Did the Earth look like it did today?
Well, the Earth looked a lot different when it got started. It was just a bunch of particles out in space. But that's for an astronomy lecture. Anyway, it got together, and as the particles got together, it got hot as a result of all the things that happen when lots of particles get together. And we ended up with an Earth, which is really cool. Not cool. It's hot. So that it means that things are changing on the surface of the Earth. And the little picture that I have up there, Prathap, is it shows that things are moving on the surface of the Earth. When I was your age, down here, the folks in the front row, when I was your age, we thought things didn't move around. But now we know they do move around. And so Australia is a moving place. We're moving north. We're moving and crashing into Asia. And if you all could be here in about 55 million years, we wouldn't have to take an airplane to Hong Kong or Beijing. We could just walk. So this is something that's really kind of interesting from the point of view of the last 500 million years, and the animals and plants have had to take that into account. So this is kind of cool. It's cool, but it's hot.
So to explain to the kids, how are we actually moving? I can see in this picture you've got up there that something folding underneath something else. Could you explain?
Well, something down there called the mantle. Well, the core is hot, very, very hot. And the heat from the core goes out into the mantle and goes up, which is that orange bit. And it goes up, and it's actually like a pot of boiling soup. Go and take a look next time you have some pea soup. And just watch that things are moving around in there. So you heat something from the bottom, and it expands, and it moves up. And because those things, which has a fancy name called convection cells, because they're doing that, the crust, which is what we live on, that really, really thin black stuff there on the very top, is actually, it's affected. And so it moves. It moves where the convection cell comes up, where the hot stuff comes up and starts to cool off. It gives you volcanoes and things like that. And as that new stuff is added, it pushes those black bits, the plates, it pushes them apart. And then, because the Earth's not expanding, it has to go down someplace, so it goes down where it cools off as it moves away from that hot place, and you get earthquakes there, like in Japan. that black plate, which we call the Earth's crust, or it's got another big fancy name called the lithosphere, if you want to use that and fool all your friends, that then goes down as it's cooled, and we have earthquakes in Japan, we have earthquakes in off the west coast of South America, and so forth. We'll have to do another podcast where we really look at the detail of that. But we know quite a lot about it because we study volcanoes, we study earthquakes, and they have a very special distribution on the surface of the Earth. And they certainly affect us a lot, but we know where they're happening, and we know why they're happening where they happen.
So do any of the kids up here want to give us their ideas of where Australia might have been going back, let's say, a few billion years ago? Want to come to the microphone? Everywhere. Australia was everywhere.
Mm-hmm. Well, this is the closest we've in the last 50 million years. Both of you are right, because they have been everywhere, depending upon where, well, not maybe everywhere, but lots of different places. But in the last, say, 100 million years, we used to be smack dab zipped up with Antarctica. And so these dinosaurs, like this is Atlas Copcosaurus, named after a famous mining equipment company because they helped us. Atlas Copcosaurus, when she was alive, lived down near the South Pole. And yet they were living, we've got their bones right here down at Inverloch. So Inverloch used to be near the South Pole. Aren't you glad that the weather out there today is not as if we were about 10 degrees from the South Pole? It's cold, but it would have been very cold then. That's a really good question, but koalas, when we were that far south, weren't around. They hadn't come on the scene yet. They were off stage, and so they didn't come on board until maybe 40, 50 million years ago, and then we were moving north. So they didn't have to have, you know, they really didn't have to deal with that kind of cold. They were smart.
So he was the most accurate with his assessment of where Australia was. I think that deserves a prize, don't you agree?
I think they both deserve a prize because if you're looking back through time to a billion or 2 billion, they were all over the place. So I think maybe two prizes in this case. One was looking at the more overall, and he was looking at the more recent. Excellent. New scientist in the making.
So we're talking about the Earth changed its look. The mm-hmm. tectonic plates have changed their positions. I've heard there was a huge, big singular landmass that we were all in one continent. Is that true?
It's true twice, and maybe twice. Three times, because in the past they've got. I love all these names. I like names, and if you use them, then you can sound like you're really smart, which you might not be. Rodinia was a big, big, big continent that existed about, really, really huge, that existed about 600-700 million years ago. Then it kind of broke apart, and another continent formed called Gondwana. Well, first it was Pangaea, which is a great big continent that included the northern hemisphere and the southern hemisphere. Then that broke apart, and Gondwana came into it. And Gondwana is one of our favorites. I mean, we've got bands named after it. We've got food named after it. We've got all kinds. Gondwana is great. So there have been many different arrangements of continents to make big ones and break them up and put them back together again.
Yeah, we've got a question over here. You want to come to the microphone?
You'll have to come to the microphone because I can't hear. I'm half deaf. Cool. Don't think it's on. I didn't understand. I don't think the microphone is on.
Ask again.
Is there a switch? Maybe Prathap can.
Oops, there we are.
Okay.
We're going to make you do it third time.
Third time around. Lucky.
Just because we like it so much.
Well, they said that one plate actually said that it split apart from the sun. And they also said that it split apart from Antarctica.
Well, all of those things happened. I mean, the sun is when all of these particles got together and the planets formed and the sun formed, they were sort of in a glum, like you took your glue and you got all these particles and put them together. And so then the Earth and the sun came into the whole universe, well, not the universe, the solar system that we live in came in. So after that got going and the Earth became a solid object, then the continent started moving. So both those things have happened, but kind of in the order of first you got to get the sun and the planets, and after the planets form and they get solid, then things start to move. Not everywhere, though. Mars used to move. Things on Mars used to move. They don't do it anymore. Yep.
Wasn't... Is Earth 4.3 billion years
old? Spot on.
Oh, yes.
Yay! Yay! Plus or minus.
I think that might deserve something
I
as
think,
well.
I think so.
Let's see, what have we got in our goodie bag here? There we go. All right, so we're talking about these massive big supercontinents and they've split apart, moved into a kind of arrangement similar to what, not quite similar to what we've got today, but kind of getting there. At what point did life appear?
Well, life probably appeared quite early. I mean, now every time I read Science Magazine or something like that, life is getting older and older and older. And so not too long after the Earth formed and solidified do we have things around. They're not things like Auntie Frank and Uncle Janine or something like that. they're bacteria. And things like that that were around, and the world was like that for a long, long time before anything more complicated got going.
So, do we know how long ago it was when life arose?
I think the current, the max date is about 4.1 billion.
So, 4.1 billion years ago, and we've heard just then from that very smart young man that it was about 4.3 billion years old.
But that's an area of contention. It's an area of current research. So, who knows? Yeah.
So they would be very different to the life we understand today.
Well, maybe, I mean, we wouldn't be there, and certainly complicated animals wouldn't be there, but, you know, your common gut bacteria might have been around. The bacteria are really long-living things. They've been around for a very long time. I wish the human race would have the same chance. If we learn how to behave, maybe so.
And so were a lot of those sorts of life the single-celled kind
yes,
of animals?
Yes, single-celled things.
So at what point... At what point do all these single cells form together and turn into mats or slime or something like that?
Well, those are the complicated things. And I've done this cartoon. One of my favorite artists did this cartoon just showing that's about 600 million years ago when you start getting things that look like they're more complicated and more cells around. And maybe as far back as 1.2, 1.3 billion. There's been a recent article in Science that says it goes back to 2.3, but that's still being thought about. And so we need more information. There's a lot of questions out there for that. You've got a standing ovation.
Well, recently I found out that Earth... was like Venus at one stage, and Venus was like Earth.
First is right. Venus, the Earth was probably like Venus at one time, and it went through a phase where it was really, really hot. Venus is interesting because it's very close to the sun, so it's in a different place than we are, and it's going to remain hotter for longer. Many of the things that are going on in Venus right now are going on Earth, but the thing that's different about Venus and us is their atmosphere. I really wouldn't want to go live there at all because it's really full of gases that are not good for us to breathe. So they've been through, a similar thing, and Earth probably never will get... It's been as hot as Venus is today, but it probably will never go back there. So they've got similar things, but Venus is different from Earth because it's closer to the sun, and it will always have a slightly... It'll be kind of, in a way, behind us in one way and ahead of us in another way. But just keep your eye on it.
Excuse me.
Yes.
What is the Earth made up of? Some kind of germs?
Oh, the germs are good. Yeah, but there's life there that you would call germs, but a lot of them are cool.
And they get themselves out, and some survived and turned into different shapes.
Oh, a lot of them are different shapes, yeah. And when you start looking inside some of these little single-celled organisms, they have lots of very complicated things in them. You know, some of them actually have things called chloroplasts inside them. They're like what you see the green in plants, and they're very lazy because they just sit around there and let the chloroplast generate the energy for them, and they don't have to go out and get food. There's even some more complicated organisms that do that too. Keep looking at the germs. Wouldn't have any idea. But you know, there's some pretty complicated chemistry out there, and I kind of reckon that one of these days we're going to find bacteria or something like that someplace else in the universe.
And you might be interested in a topic called astrobiology, and that's exactly what you're talking about there. It's a topic called panspermia, but we won't go into that right now, but it's a very good question there.
But I would add to that, we don't know that yet, and therefore it is really, really, really important to take care of this Earth and not be thinking about we're going to be able to go someplace else if we ruin this place. This is very special here, and so far it's the only place we know where there is complex life. So when you grow up, do everything you possibly can to look after the environment and your fellow human beings.
Was Hylonomus the first reptile?
I wouldn't have a clue. If you bring me the spelling of that, I'll look it up and let you know. Because I don't work on reptiles. That's a pretty good name, though. Come and see me after the lecture. We'll go and look it up on eBay. Not eBay. We might buy one, yeah. We'll go look it up on Wikipedia or something. I might like to buy one. It would be good.
Possibly by the bones, I guess.
Well, it might. That'd be good. I wouldn't. No, no. I'd trade the bones. Don't buy bones. Not a good idea to deal that way. But I'd find out who had it and go and see if I could trade one of my little dinosaurs for theirs. We'll follow that up.
So we've got the single cellular animals here. Mm-hmm. How did they evolve to something more complex? Do we know how that happened?
Well, if you put a couple of more slides on there, we can see what some of these really early ones. This is where I find them. These are two places in the world that I love to go. That's in Namibia in southern Africa, and the next one is right here in our backyard in the Flinders, and that's where some of these first really complicated animals show up. The next few little slides to give you an idea what they look like. Not like anything you've ever seen before. That used to be thought to be a worm, but it's not a worm. It's all different. Next one is an animal that's cool. I've got a soft toy of this up in my office. I'll have to bring it down. But it's a thing perhaps related to the, if you take a look at the next slide, perhaps related to snails. But it is really, if you go back, Sandra, it's really quite different because instead of like snails that have these little teeth that get stuff and then they move forward and they get some more stuff and they get some more stuff, these guys actually had... they moved backwards, and they were eating slime. They were eating bacteria. They love bacterial mats. They thought this was delicious. So in Japan, they would be just fine because they would love sushi. Next slide is the snail, and the next slide after that is one of these things about the size of my fist from Russia. We can see inside these things. These are about 600 million years old, and they're big. They've got many, many cells. And the next slide is kind of a reconstruction of what we think they look like. Now, what those branching things inside are, we're not sure whether they're blood vessels, their gut thing, their distribution for food or whatever. Let's see what the next slide is. Now, Peter Trussler, who's the artist that works with me, he's done some reconstructions of what we think some of these first many-celled things look like. And perhaps question about how did this happen, lots and lots of single cells managed to get together, and they... it's a complicated process, but it happened, and it happened probably many times, and started doing different jobs. They're multi-celled organisms, the cells, like in you know, you have things that smell, you have things that are in your go to make your brain up. You've got lots of different kinds of cells doing different things, and so that happened over a period of time.
So, got a couple of questions here.
Yep.
Up to the front. You want to come to the microphone?
Fossils go into rocks?
Well, there's many, many ways with these, because these guys here and gals, well, they were guys and gals, there were boys and girls of these, they just left their impression in the sediment, and then the sediment got cooked as it went down underground, and those impressions were preserved. They didn't have bones like you and I. They didn't have shells like snails. So it was just an impression of the top of them most of the time. So that's how they got preserved. Sometimes you get things petrified, like wood. You get silicon getting into the cells, and it precipitates. In other words, it gets laid down. And so you get something preserved like that. It replaces things. There's a lot of different ways fossils can be formed. But these guys were just impressions, which make them really difficult to interpret. You don't know what you're looking at, really. Good question.
That snail you showed before, was it a gastropod?
It's a gastropod, yes. That's the scientific name for it. You're really on your way to being a taxonomist. I haven't shown one yet, but there's a trilobite coming up. Just the next slide should be a trilobite. No, to go beyond. Well, there's a trilobite in there. There's a trilobite for you. Now, those animals had many cells, but they were smart. They had shells. And if you go back to the previous slide, that shows the difference between the animals that lived about 550 million years ago on the left-hand side and the animals that lived on the right-hand side that are younger than that. And the animals, two really important things happened. The ocean, the whole chemistry of the ocean changed about that time at the end of a big glacial, but there were animals got eyes. Before this, they didn't have eyes, and so there were no big predators. So it really didn't matter if you had a shell. You weren't going to be eaten. And so animals got eyes. You see that great big thing floating around in the water on the right-hand side? That's a thing called anomalocaris. We've got fossils of that over in South Australia. That was a big, mean predator with eyeballs. And so it could say, ha-ha, there's something down on the floor, I'm going to go get it, gobble, gobble. So two things happened. Animals had to have got a shell. There was a real pressure for getting shells, and they started digging holes in the ground because they wanted to get away from these nasty predators. So eyes came in, big predators came in, and so that led to shells and animals that could dig holes in the sea floor. Yep. That's one of those big, nasty predators that got eyes. And boy, they love trilobites. Just like us eating shrimp. Boy, they went after the trilobites. You can see bite marks sometimes in trilobite shells. Okay, good. Good questions.
What is a ryankosaurus?
What?
I asked, what is a ryankosaurus?
I wouldn't have a clue either. I'll have to get you, I'll have to have you spell the name. And then I can help you find it. It's obvious if it's a saurus, it's got to be a reptile of some kind. It could be a dinosaur. It could be another reptile.
I don't know how you spell it.
We'll have to find out how we spell it. There's all kinds of pronunciations. So you think about it, and after I get through with the talk, we'll sit down and see if we can find out. I've got lots of reference books.
And just before the next question,
yep.
According to Twitter, Hieronymus, so thank you, Rogliate, the
yep.
anonymous Rogliate, is the first known reptile.
Okay. We'll check it out. Thank you, Twitter.
Didn't some of those sea creatures climb to land to make the land dinosaurs?
Dinosaurs started out on the land, but some of those ancient reptiles. But before that, of course, fish got on land, went through a stage we call amphibians, which is a great big category. And then after that, from the amphibians came the reptiles that gave rise to the dinosaurs, yeah. It's a long stage.
So let's pick up on that a little bit. A lot of these creatures evolve in the water.
Yep.
And do we know at one point creatures move from water to land?
Well, now people are thinking not just the creatures but the plants that moved on to land. Even when some of these guys on the left-hand side of the picture were there, there were probably fungi and there were probably bacteria that were living on land. In fact, there was an article I read of few weeks ago called the greening of the land, and it wasn't the greening of the plants that we have out there now, but actually it was algae that was going on and actually getting onto land. So plants, that we know that have leaves and stems and stuff like that didn't probably get onto land till a time called the Silurian, which was over 300 million years ago. But that was in comparison to what actually got onto land first, probably fungus, bacteria, algae were up there in the soils. So, we're
talking about all these things that have happened. How do we know that's actually how it happened? How does science tell us that this is how
it
was?
Well, we look at fossils. We have to go back as geologists. The beginning of the lecture that I had the title on was called the Travels of a Rockhead or something like that. And geologists, paleontologists, are really the people that look at rocks and they put them in order and they try to figure out what went on. They also look at the chemistry of the rocks. You can take a look and look for signatures left by the chemicals, and that'll give you some idea sometimes of what the ocean was like. For instance, did it have a lot of oxygen in it or didn't it? Did it have a lot of selenium in it or didn't it? And so it's the geologists, and there's a whole range of people that work in geology. It's not just paleontologists, but it's geochemists and geophysicists and all of that. Mm-hmm. We all work together and try to figure out the order in which things happened and what the evidence is for it.
So you mentioned that life might have appeared several times, and we're now talking about moving from the oceans onto land. Do we know what caused particular species of plants and animals to be more successful than others?
Pre-adapted. I mean, they just happen to have the right genetics. Just like when you're breeding cows or rabbits or whatever, you want something that has a particular color or you want something that flies faster. I mean, it basically, natural selection is the thing that takes the place of human selection. Mm-hmm. So if you just happen to have the right combination of genetics and you're there and climate changes or something changes, you will be either selected for or selected against. So it's a selection for the right genetics. How do you get the right genetics? Well, when mom and pop have children, they combine their genetics, and it sometimes doesn't, the children do not come out looking exactly like the parents. They have a different genetic makeup. And so natural history, the natural world selects for the right combination at the right time.
So that technique is millennia old.
Of course, since life. Since you had multi-celled organisms where you had a mom and a pop. You weren't just basically dividing and having the same thing over and over again with the only possibility of change being a mutation. But if you have a mother and a father giving rise to an offspring, it's a different combination of genetics. And so, you know, I hope my kids don't have the same crossed eyes that I do or something like that.
So we've been talking about natural selection. Now we're going to go with human selection. So if we could get our special helper to choose a listener of the episode from someone here today. If you can go to the microphone, tell us your name.
Charlotte.
Where you're Hello, Charlotte. And where are you from?
Fentry Gully.
Fentry Gully. What school do you go to?
St. John the Baptist Primary School.
And what interested you in coming here today?
I don't really know.
That's nice and honest. So what have you enjoyed most so far?
How the answers and the new names I've heard.
A lot of the new names.
Different types of dinosaurs and the core of the earth and what's around it and how the earth moves.
So keep an ear out, because after this break we're going to go into talking about dinosaurs. But for being today's listener of the episode, you're going to get a prize. There you are. Another question. Okay. Let's go with a couple of questions.
Three, four. Okay. Do you have a question? Okay. Everyone, make a line.
trapped. There might be some trapped in the ground of the sea.
Usually not too much, but it depends on where you are in the sea, how much oxygen there is. And how much, so sometimes the bottom of the sea can have a lot of oxygen and sometimes it can't. And it really depends, the animals that can live there really depends on them. I mean, if you take a diving bell down, you can take some air under the sea, but it's pretty difficult to find air down there that's not dissolved in the water. Okay, thank you for that.
I was looking on the internet the other day and I saw that you used TNT and sledgehammers to find some fossils.
You're right.
Wouldn't you think that if you use the TNT, you'd blow up the fossils?
No, it's a good question. It's a good comment, but you have to be very careful. And we didn't use TNT. We used gelignite, which is a very soft explosive. And what you do is you never, never use that in the bed that's got the fossils in it. You only use that down to about a meter above that bed, and you take off the, what we call the overburden. You never, ever would use that on a fossil bed. You're absolutely right on that, because it would blow things to smithereens. But you also have to pick the kind of explosive you're going to use, because TNT would be too sharp. Gelignite is a little different, even though that's being very precise. But that's a good question.
After the Earth was made, did another planet about the size of the moon crash into Earth?
The moon may have crashed into Earth. I don't know astrophysics very well, but there's certainly one of the things that he was singing about, I think, if I understood. When we have things coming in from outer space like asteroids, they hit the Earth, and they have been really, really important in major extinctions of dinosaurs and other things. So not quite the size of the moon, but pretty big anyway. You wouldn't want one to land in Melbourne.
And is that how the continents were made?
No, the continents were affected by that, but that's not how the continents were made. Good question.
So there were herbivores, but then there came armored carnivores some stage.
Yeah, but remember that carnivores preyed on other carnivores, so yeah, it'd be a good idea if you were a little carnivore or a medium-sized carnivore to get some armor someplace. Yeah. Okay. Not all of them have it, but some of them certainly do.
Did Australia stretch when it split from Antarctica?
Tell me again.
Did Australia stretch when it split from Antarctica?
Yes, it did. Yeah, it did. About started about 110 million and slowly, about 45, 48 is when the last connection between Tasmania and Tasmania and Antarctica went through. Yeah, disconnected. I'm glad, actually. It'd be too cold here.
And one last question.
Just wondering, you know how I mentioned that Rhynchosaurus thing?
Yes.
I don't know how to spell it.
We'll find out.
I got it off a dinosaur discovery.
Maybe Twitter could look it up on the Wikipedia. You and I, when this is over, you come up and you pronounce it to me, and I'll write it down.
I've got a dinosaur CD, and it's got some movies, and it's got one that mentions an animal called
Rhynchosaurus. Well, we'll take a look at that. I'll have to try looking on my book. You can tell that scientists don't know everything. I mean, they do. They have certain areas that they specialize in, and a good scientist, if they don't know an answer, will tell you they don't know an answer, and they'll go look it up. They don't know each scientist doesn't know everything. Good.
I'm a very good scientist. There's a lot I don't know.
That's right.
Well, we started talking about dinosaurs, so let's go on to them. When did dinosaurs first appear?
If you go forward in the... Ooh, why are we there? You're going to have to go a bit further forward. Okay, that's fine. Back to the one before with Corey. This is where we used the gelignite to get underground. Dinosaurs, and this is down in the Yawai Ranges, and those dinosaurs there are about 110, 120 million years old. But dinosaurs first, and again, there's a lot of things going on in science, right, in scientific research now, They may go back as far as 230 million, and it wouldn't surprise me if they, you know, as time goes on, that they get a little bit further back in time. If you'd asked me that question 10 years ago, I would have said about 180, 190. So there's more discoveries being made all the time. So they go back quite a ways. So that's how we had to dig things out in our cave, which we made.
So once you find these dinosaur bones, how can you tell what the dinosaurs look like just from the bones? Because, you know, there's an exhibition just behind us there, for those of you who haven't seen it, with a big set of bones there. And one of the competitions for the kids to do is actually draw what they think the dinosaur looks like. So given a bone or a set of bones, how do we know what it looks like and how big it was and what colour it might have been and all those sorts of things?
Well, over there against that case is a cast of a little dinosaur related to our dinosaurs here in Australia. It's a thing called an ornithopod. You can see its skull and you can see its legs. And so you have to start out, if you're lucky enough to get a skeleton, and you have to look at the skeleton and you have to measure it, and then the trick becomes, how do you reconstruct it? Like back on the back wall is another reconstructed animal. That's a dinosaur too. That's named after Arthur C. Clarke, because he started being interested in science when he started looking at his father's cards that he got that had dinosaurs on them. So what you have to do is look at the bones, and you have to look at all the little projections and things on the bones where muscles attach, and then you have to start trying to reconstruct where the muscles attached. How do we know to even start that? Well, we have to look at modern reptiles and even modern mammals, because they have the kind of mechanical setup like many of the dinosaurs did. So it becomes, in a way, theory from the time you go from the skeleton. Skeleton, you can get an idea how big the animal is. You can get an idea of how everything fit together. But when you start putting muscles and flesh on it, then that becomes, you have to really know your modern anatomy. You have to know a lot about how animals move. Peter Trussler, who is our artist, and I have to make a plug for this. This book is coming out on the 16th of September, and basically it answers Pradip's question in more detail than you want to know. It's a thing called The Artist and the Scientist, and it's about how over 30 years, Peter Trussler and Tom, my husband, and I, and a whole bunch of other scientists have gone from bones to the final illustration. Some people do it very briefly and very imaginatively, but Peter is one of those people who he would spend a year making a reconstruction like the big bird that's out there in the front of the museum when you come in, and that one is there. It took him a year to do that because we had to know the bones, we had to know the closest relatives, we had to know the color is based on the closest relatives. So it's a long, long process. It's not something like, I've got this skeleton over here, and I think I'm going to do a drawing of it today and make it look just like I think it looked 110 million years ago. Well, you can do that, but what you'll come up with is something that's extremely imaginative and probably 9 times out of 10 not spot on. So it's a complicated process if you do it right.
And I can understand how you can do obviously with a decent understanding of paleontology and anatomy and all those sorts of things, how if you have a full skeleton you could do that. What about the instances where you find partial skeletons from extinct species? How do you know what it looks like from that? So I've heard, for example, that scientists talking about, here's a particular bone, this creature must have been 2 meters long, for example. How do you get from there to there?
You have to go around the world and look in collections to find the closest relative that is known from a skeleton, and that's the only way you can do it. Because if you just have a thigh bone, you don't know whether the thigh bone has the same proportions as something that has that thigh bone that size. Mm-hmm. And so you're making a guess. And the only way that you can get close to the mark is if you've got something more complete. And this should show up in the paper you write on it. You should say, I only have part of it. This is the reason I'm making this reconstruction, because I've got a full skeleton someplace else that's close to it. And that's as far as you should go. You have to be very cautious about the things that you say when you have fragmentary material. And people who don't do that are not doing science right. You don't give information. You don't make reconstructions that are far beyond what you have the basic information for.
And so how do you know that the bones you find are the same kind of creature as another skeleton or another set of bones?
Comparison. I mean, you really have to be a good anatomist. You have to go, and sometimes, for instance, identifying our material, we had to go to the British Museum, we had to go to Berlin, we had to go to a lot of places and look at the collections that had material that related to, you know, that was close to us. And that means every fine little detail that you see on that bone, you have to compare them carefully. Mm-hmm. So it's a long process. It's not easy. And particularly in Australia, it's not easy because we don't have lots of skeletons and we don't have huge comparative collections here. I mean, the British Museum has been around a little bit longer than the Australian Museum and the Museum Victoria. And the Paris Museum and things like that, they have material that goes back to the 1700s or even earlier than that. And they also have material from places where dinosaurs are much more complete, like Mongolia or Western United States, and those are the two places really that have produced most of the dinosaurs.
Given what we were talking about at the start of the show about all the land masses having been joined together, do we find fossils all around the world, or is it particular places that they're more common?
It depends on what you're looking for. I mean, if you're looking for dinosaurs, like I said, Western North America and Central Asia are the two places, and China are the three places that actually produce most of the stuff. There's material from South America, and there's material from Antarctica, mm-hmm. but again, it's much rarer, although South America is growing. There's more and more material coming in. Antarctica is a problem because most of the blooming continent is covered up with ice, so unless you have you want to go melt the ice cap, which I don't think we want to do. You're going to... We're trying our best, but paleontologists should be getting ready to go in their boats. But some areas are better than others. But if you're looking for Precambrian material, like I look for, it's different places because the rocks have got to be there, and they've got to be exposed, and so different groups are found in different places in quantity or lack thereof.
And... We've been talking about bones primarily at the moment. Is it just bones that are fossilized?
No, not at all. These things from the Precambrian certainly were, we don't have them up there now, but these were the little guys that just were the impressions. So you can just get impressions. You can get wood being preserved. You get pollen and spores being preserved. These are the things that plants throw out there after they've made new plants. And so lots and lots of different kinds of fossils and lots of different kinds of preservation too.
So how much study is done on the plant side of things? We've been primarily talking about animals so far.
Yeah.
So what people who study plants look for are those spores and that wood that you're talking about.
Yeah. There's a lot of people, particularly people in the oil industry, because those kinds of spores and pollen and also little tiny microscopic organisms that live in the sea, like dinoflagellates and foraminifera, those things are there in the billions, and they are very important for... helping people decide whether they should drill an oil well in one place or not. They help you tell the age of the rocks. Mm-hmm. So there's just a wonderful array of different kinds of fossils out there.
So we've got a couple of questions mm-hmm. up here. So
Sandra, you might turn to the next slide too. There would be some. Yeah, that's good.
Is Microraptor the smallest prehistoric bird?
I won't answer that question right now because there's a number of them being reported on from China at the moment that might be smaller than that. You just have to wait for about a year or two and look at the publications, and I might be able to give you a more firm answer. There's some really neat stuff coming in from a place called Liaoning up in the northeast side of China. That's the best place to go and get birds, fossil young old birds. But that's a pretty small one.
Was it the fastest?
Hard to tell. I can't get in my Taurus and go back and time them. But pretty fast.
Can dinosaur talk with another animals?
I'm sure that dinosaurs had ways of communicating. One of my friends actually did a study on some hadrosaurs. And hadrosaurs are dinosaurs that get all sorts of funny things on their head. They have things that look like horns, or they have things that look like really complicated noses. And he actually started blowing air through some of these. He reconstructed them and blew air. And they were making sounds like, ooh, ooh, or they could. And so I think they, quote, talk by making noises, like animals, like most animals communicate. Whales, for instance. And they're talking to one another. So not like you and I, but I think dinosaurs most likely communicated with one another with noise, many of them.
Yeah, thanks for those questions. And so we're talking about the different types of skeletons we found. What are the range of sizes that we found dinosaurs in?
from really tiny to really big.
So what's really big? We all sort of hear about T-Rex, and is that the biggest?
No, he's really pretty small relative to some of the things we call sauropods. I always remember this picture in National Geographic, and it was really cute. It was there was a sauropod baby that had just hatched out of an egg that was about that size. This is not a sauropod. This is a theropod. Well, no, actually, this is a herbivore. This is an ornithopod. So this baby was about like, well, he was even smaller than that. This baby was about like that. But the parent grew up to the point where the head could go through the ceiling. So they
so
the
for
range.
Those people listening to the podcast or streaming, that's probably about, what would you say, about 15 meters?
It's about 20? 10 people high. 10 Maybe 10 people high. So they get really.
Wasn't the brachiosaurus the tallest?
It used to be, but there's another one. There's a thing called gigantosaurus, and there's another one that is just being published from South America that makes the brachiosaurus look like it's a small cousin. It's some of these that are just enormous. I don't know how in the world they got enough food in their mouths to keep themselves going. But Supersaurus is one, but he's not the biggest. And there's another one, again, so much of this stuff is in publication from South America that will make Brachiosaurus look about three-quarters the size of what the one in South America is. It hasn't been named yet. I guess they're getting out of Ultra and Super and Super Duper. Maybe it'll be Super Dupersaurus. Humongousaurus. That would be... I like that one.
Argentinosaurus was the biggest so far.
So far published, possibly. I think that it would be running neck and neck, literally, with Supersaurus from Utah.
No pun intended.
But they're big. They're really, really big. I guess it depends on how they stand. If they were slouched, maybe they'd be shorter than if they stood up straight. Good. Good
Thank
question.
Thank you for those questions. Given that some of the sizes that we're talking about,
mm-hmm.
Did that imply that there was a different amount of oxygen at that time and a different amount of vegetation around? Because some of these herbivores, they would have had to have consumed a lot to support a body like that.
And if it was warm-blooded, yes, but if it was cold-blooded, maybe not anywhere. It's the metabolism level. It depends on that. And levels, oxygen and carbon dioxide levels were quite varying in the Mesozoic, and people are studying that, but I still haven't got my head around all that. Mm-hmm. Certainly, there was lots of plants, and there was lots of CO2, and therefore perhaps less than O2, less O2. I don't feel comfortable talking about that in any kind of scientific way. And so I'm not sure that we actually have enough data to be talking about it too much.
So we had a question earlier about communication. Do we know what dinosaurs might have sounded like? I remember watching Land of the Lost when I was a kid, and there was always a particular sound coming from these cartoon dinosaurs. Were they just made up by the animators, or is there a way for us to find out how they actually sounded?
Well, this guy in the US, whose name slips my mind, did this study that I was talking to one of the students about, where he actually took and reconstructed the head of some of these hadrosaurs and blew air through it, and he came up with a number of sounds that were quite feasible, that they could have actually produced that amount of breath to blow it through that, and that those chambers in some of these hadrosaurs were basically resonating chambers. So that's the closest you can get, unless you've got a torus.
So all this stuff really sort of blows my mind, really. From having a few bones, you can actually construct what the creatures look like and have their colours based on the spacing of the molecules for the pigment. Blowing air through, we can understand how they sound. I think a lot of the kids here, and especially a couple up at the front here, might be really excited about this as an area of study. It's just amazing.
Well, another thing you can do, the picture that's on the screen is my girl when she was about 12, and she has a dinosaur named after her called Leelinosaura amicographica, named after her. Friends of the museum here in Melbourne and the National Geographic Society, all of who had helped us a lot. And she's got a little skull that's sitting there that is really interesting, because that little skull is about like that. You can tell from her size and the size of the skull. and it's looking down on top of it, you can actually see that it's got huge eyes. It had a big eye socket, so it was a really, really animal that could see, we think, in the dark. The other thing it's got is the impression of the brain, because there's the brain rotted away, the sediment got in there, and if you could take the top of your head off and take a look, your brain makes an impression on the underside of your skull. So we know what the top of the brain looks like. Her brothers would contest this, but she had a good brain. She had a really big, smart brain, but she had really, really big optic lobes. And it was much bigger, those optic lobes were much bigger in this little dinosaur than a very close relative that lived in Texas. I mean, you might have your own attitude about that, but the one that lived in Texas at the same time was very, very close to the equator. And so the optic lobes in this brain were not very, you couldn't see them in the top of the brain. So the conclusion for that, big eyes, big part of the brain that was dedicated to sight, this animal could probably see under very low light conditions. And it lived at about 75 to 80 degrees south. So we think that this dinosaur probably was one that actually could can continue to be active during the darkness of winter, which would have been 3 months of darkness. 3 months of darkness. So you can do more than just look at the bones and the attachments. You can actually start looking at the soft tissues and try to work out from there what the dinosaur was able to do.
So how long did dinosaurs last on Earth?
Well, if you take the date of 230 to about 65 million, you can do the mathematics. They lasted for quite a long time. If we last that long, I'd be really pleased. In fact, I want to try to outdo the dinosaurs if we can. So millions and millions and millions of years.
We're only like, if you looking at the clock face and use that as a timing of the Earth, we've appeared in the last second, haven't we?
Yep. So let's just keep going. Let's do it, but do it well.
So let's start talking a little bit about your work. We've seen the picture of your daughter there. What were some of your favorite discoveries?
Every one of them. As I said, one of my favorite things that I've done in my life is being able to lead two expeditions into Central Arabia, and I really enjoyed that because it's a difficult place for a woman to lead an expedition, and we're still working there, and it's fantastic. So that's one thing. It's a highlight in my life. But, I mean, just being able to be a scientist, just being able to do research, being able to ask questions and be curious, that's the most important thing to me.
And did you want to make a comment about some of the Australian dinosaurs that you've worked with? Because a lot of the books we read, they talk about North American dinosaurs and so on. But we've got our own bunch, haven't we?
And when I came here in 1975, it really made me annoyed that we didn't have books on our dinosaurs. We already had dinosaurs then, so I set about with my friends to write a whole bunch of them, and there's a whole bunch of them out there that now has it. If Sandra goes forward a little bit, there's Leelanosaura in the one back, and one of the things that we have found really interesting, it's really kind of hard to get money to do scientific research in paleo, so we've taken some alternative routes, and one of them is that Australia Post has supported us immensely, because we went to them, and we've got we did a dinosaur stamp issue and a couple of other ones, and they've supported our research. This was one that was done for the dinosaur stamps, and that actually made the cover of Time magazine, which we were very pleased to see. This is Peter. You'll see this in this book. Next one is another one that we've worked on. We named it after Qantas because Qantas helped us. We were going different ways of getting funding for research. So I'm trying. The next slide shows the Qantasaurus that Peter has drawn. It's different than, it's related to the Leelanosaur, which is like that skeleton over there, but it's really got a short, stubby face. We call it the bulldog of the ornithopods. And then the next slide shows what I want Qantas to do. We're going to try to get them to paint one of their airplanes with their Qantasaurus on it. And they said, well, we don't want to put a dinosaur on our planes because you don't want to be called a corporate dinosaur. And I said, look, you've got the big N here. Dinosaurs gave rise to birds, and all the rest of the dinosaurs went extinct except the ones that gave rise to birds, and therefore they fly. I think it's perfect for you to put on your plane. You're the survivor of the great extinction of the corporate dinosaurs. And the next slide shows the stamps, I think. No, it's Tim who's in there doing the cast. He's got his own dinosaur, too, named after Timimus. It's called Timimus. It's named after him and Tim Flannery, because Tim Flannery is a great hero of mine and also one of our students from Monash. And the next slide shows the stamps. Now, those stamps, basically, because we worked with them, those came out the same time Jurassic Park came out. And those stamps, when they were issued, Australia Post gave us money for research, and it also made sure that every school in Australia had an education kit telling about the dinosaurs in Australia. So Australia Post, to me, is a great hero. They've done many, many things. And those are our dinosaurs. Lielanosaurus on the left, an allosauroid, the next one, the 45-cent stamp there. Mutaburosaurus from up in Queensland, which is the 75-cent stamp. Another 45 one there with one of our flying reptiles, which is not a dinosaur. Down the 105 is another one of those Queensland dinosaurs, but we now have them in Victoria too, called Minmi, which is an armored herbivore. And the final one over there is Tamimus, which is it's a dinosaur that used to be a carnivore but is actually now eating insects and small lizards, we think. So, yes, that gives us a good view of Australian dinosaurs, and it was Australia Post that made it possible for us to have those illustrated and out there in the real world.
And, just want to finish up on one question, then we'll go to four questions. Did you want to talk to us about the Australian tyrannosauroid that you found?
Yep, the tyrannosauroid is a very fragmentary specimen of a pelvis. Of something, and I don't know why that Tyrannosaurus rex and its relatives are so popular, but it's a fragmentary pelvis that we know belongs in that group. We can't give it it's not T-Rex, but it's a thing that's in that group with Tyrannosaurus. But that thing, we published it in Science, and it's gone around the world. Everybody thinks if it's Tyrannosaurus or something related to T-Rex, it's the most wonderful thing in the world. I think, quite frankly, the skeleton of Lielanosaurus is much more important. Nobody's interested.
All right, let's.
Have to get in line. Yeah, have to get in line. Hi.
Was Lipurita, did Lipurodon have the biggest jaw?
I don't know. Don't know that dinosaur. You got more dinosaurs than I know.
Is the thing in Jurassic Park where they use the mosquitoes legit?
No, it's not legit because DNA breaks down too quickly. One thing I've found out, though, looking at stuff that is that old, you still can get collagen, which is interesting. So you can't recreate a dinosaur based on collagen, but you can actually look at collagen and the structure of collagen because it stays together. I wish DNA would stay together longer, but it doesn't. So no, it's not legit, but it's a good story.
Exactly how strong was T-Rex's jaws?
How strong was?
Tyrannosaurus Rex's jaws.
There have been some studies done on the force that can be, can be generated, but I don't know the answer to that one either. But they certainly would have been quite able to take a chunk of meat out of a sauropod and absolutely twist it out.
Mutaburosaurus?
What?
Isn't Mutaburosaurus like Iguanodon?
It's related. Yeah, it's related. And that's why, well, in fact, it's interesting. Mutaburosaurus is one of the full skeletons that we have from Australia, so that reconstruction is probably not too bad because we have a whole skeleton of it. It's interesting. But it's related to Iguanodon. Yep.
I've also heard that Tyrannosaurus rexes humans?
No, absolutely no. There's no. T-Rex was gone a long time before humans, even though Fred Flintstone wants to put them together. Oh, sorry. So, what was the question? I didn't hear it right.
Are T-Rex's arms as long as a human's arms?
Not at all. T-Rex is about like that.
Tiny arms.
Not very strong at all. No, they were being totally lost. If T-Rex had been around for another 10 million years, it probably would have had no arms at all. Just like whales, for instance, don't have legs. They've lost them.
Hi, thanks for the show. Really appreciate it. You mentioned that the 45-cent stamp flying reptile there.
Yep.
Is that a reptile or a dinosaur?
It's a reptile, but not a dinosaur.
So does does that mean dinosaurs aren't reptiles?
No, dinosaurs are reptiles. It's just there's lots of different kinds of reptiles. Reptiles is the big group, and it has things like crocodiles and lizards and dinosaurs and flying reptiles. Those are all reptiles. They're all in that big group of reptiles.
But not dinosaurs.
Dinosaurs are in there too. Dinosaurs are reptiles.
So dinosaurs are cold-blooded?
Dinosaurs are probably a mixture. We think there's good reason to suspect that some dinosaurs were warm-blooded, but maybe not like you and I. That's an ongoing debate.
So dinosaurs are reptiles?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, that's all right.
Is it true that if T-Rex ran really, really fast and tripped, it could easily die?
Well, if it hit its head on a rock, yeah, I'm sure.
Plankton was one of the biggest sea predator that lived.
It was, yeah. It was big. You guys know much more about the names than I do.
We've got one more prize. Let's make it a fairly easy question. Who can tell me how many years humans existed while dinosaurs lived?
Zero.
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 A few people got that. So, you already have a prize? Or? All right, well... Yes, here we go.
You get a reptile.
You get the snake.
A snake.
And on that note, we've got... Let's choose a grand prize winner. So I'd like to thank everybody for coming in today. And I have a very special helper who's been sitting up the back, Chris. Would you like to choose at random a grand prize winner from the audience here today? Okay, so I'll have to speak to your mum a little bit later, can get your details, but what you have won, do you want to tell everybody your name? Come up here.
I'm Harry.
Hi, Harry. Well, you've won a $200 voucher for the brainsmatter National Science Week Award from Cengage Learning, so thank you very much to the people at Cengage, where you can buy books up to the value of $200. So can everybody congratulate him. And I think you'll all agree that he asked some very good questions there. And on that note, I'd like to thank everybody here for showing up. Hope you enjoyed the show. Thanks to everybody who sent Twitter messages. You saw them up on the screen a little bit earlier. All the people listening to the live stream. Can we thank Corin at the back there for the science of chocolate discussion? For the music, could we thank Clive Weeks, who's currently performing at the moment, his wonderful rendition of Walk the Dinosaur before, which I threw at him very last minute. So he went and learned that specifically for today. For the theme music, those of you who listen to the show know that I have to thank Glenn Gertz from Modular Records and Cut Copy, the band who performed the song. The grand prize, of course, Cengage Learning. For the sound engineering, Chris Bowen up the back and Jason Haymeister. For streaming help, Mulia and Brandon. And from the Monash Science Centre, for whom none of this today would have happened, could we thank Sandra, Colleen, who's probably somewhere up the back,
Jenny,
Jamie, Tim Rich, and of course, Patricia Vickers-Rich, who's the director of the Science Centre, and our very special guest here today, and without whom none of this would have happened. And before I go, I'd like to leave you with a quote, and I always leave with a quote in all my episodes. Next in importance to freedom and justice is popular education, without which neither freedom nor justice can be permanently maintained. And that's from James A. Garfield. Thank you, everybody.
You can check out the brainstorm website. www.brainsmatter.com, and you can find all the other episodes of the show there. Just click on the podcast link on the right hand side. You can listen to the episodes from your browser by choosing Flash Player from the links and selecting whichever episode you want to hear from within the player. There's also other information on the site, such as links to articles and news, subscription details, both via iTunes and manually, and voting information. Please vote for the podcast on Podcast Alley, and remember to vote every month, since the votes reset at the start of each month. If you want to support the show, have a look at the Support the Show link. You can make a donation via PayPal, or you can buy a book through one of the Amazon links on the support page. If you have any comments or suggestions, you can leave an entry on this episode's show notes on the webpage, or you can send me an email. All my contact information can be found on the site. The theme music Future is performed by Cut Copy and comes courtesy of Glenn Gertz from Modular Records. I hope you enjoyed the show. Bye for now.